This is Divine Lifestyles with Tara Magalski. What is a divine lifestyle? Passion, purpose, and living in alignment with your truth. Thanks for tuning into Divine Lifestyles, Transforming Your Life with Purpose. We share stories of transformation to feed your spirit, mind, and body. I'm your host, Tara Magalski, and today's guest is a new dear friend of mine, Jeremy Bellotti. Jeremy, thank you so much for being here today. It is such a pleasure.
Of course. Thanks for having me. This is awesome.
Awesome. Well, let's get right to it. Jeremy Bellotti is an international speaker, author, fitness and lifestyle entrepreneur, and the go-to expert on entrepreneurial peak performance for fitness, health, and wellness influencers. He is a CPT and CFNS TEDx speaker, and by the way, his TEDx talk is amazeballs, and works with the best-selling authors, million-dollar companies, multi-million-dollar companies, and best-selling authors, and entrepreneurs, and thought leaders all around the world. So, Jeremy, let's just get right into it, because your intro is such a mouthful, because you do so much. You not only do this, you're also the CEO and founder of FitLife Entrepreneur, which I want to get to talking a little bit more about later.
Yeah.
But let's just crack right into it. I watched your TED Talk, and you talked about, I'm not sure when that was filmed, but you talked about 5 years ago being lost, depressed, and pretty much driving with everything you owned in the backseat of your car.
Yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit about what led to your transformational car ride?
What led to it, man? That's the nitty gritty. That's the raw stuff, man.
That's right.
Yeah. What led to that? Goodness, it was honestly, I would say 25 or 24 years of, I don't want to say misguided, but certainly at some level, we're all kind of raised by wolves, right? Like we're not raised. People tell us, don't do this, don't do that. But no one ever tells you not to be broke and not to not thrive and be abundant and create powerful relationships and everything like that. And I think what it was really a combination of me just not having a very clear purpose behind what I wanted to create for myself and for like the impact that I wanted to have on others. And so at the time, all that I had kind of grown up to kind of think of in terms of creating success in life was, go to school, which I did. I had gotten a bachelor's at that point. And, get a job, get some experience, and kind of build a career, right? Well, at that time, I only had a bachelor's degree of like a degree that really didn't cultivate any type of, major... I couldn't really garner
revenue stream,
yeah, anything like that. So, all I had at that point was a degree and no real major work experience. So I kind of felt like I just didn't know what I wanted to do. I didn't have a direction. I didn't have a purpose behind anything. And so I got into a really, really hopeless position, which kind of built up over the next couple of years of me. I did a few things. I mean, I played. I was kind of playing golf professionally at the time, but it was lonely. I mean, I was traveling the country. I was driving all around to different events and everything. It was extremely, extremely lonely. And I ended up kind of just in a position where I ended up living out of my car for about 6 months because I didn't have anywhere to go. It was right in the middle of the recession, if you will. So like late 2008. I ended up getting laid off. I ended up losing the place that I was staying at, and it was just a really good kick in the gut of what am I doing? What do I want to do? What am I like really looking to create here? Mm-hmm. So what happened in really mid-2009 was it just got to a tipping point where I could not go any farther. I could not take this road any farther or else it was going to be extremely, severely destructive. And it inevitably kind of turned to me, tucking my head in between my legs and, just kind of like having to drive up and live with my parents. And, kind of going through that was really the eye-opener of, okay, I just have to do something. Whatever this looks like, I have to just go in a direction. that mm-hmm. is opposite of what I'm going to right now. So that's kind of what sparked the whole drive and the whole experience of me realizing that I needed to do something and kind of allowing me to become aware of where I was at, which is one of the things that we talk about when it comes to entrepreneurial peak performance, this idea of being open to potential, your full potential in life.
Mm-hmm.
One of the key elements to that is really that first step of awareness, understanding where you're at, understanding what truly is happening around you and what influence you have on that. Mm-hmm. I didn't know that before then. I was just kind of, you know, going through the motions, hoping that something would come along my way. I had a degree, so therefore a job should just kind of, you know, fall on my plate. And I didn't have really any true understanding or respect or appreciation for my ability to create something, my ability to initiate that purpose and that meaning.
Well, now that we're on that, you refer to, in your TED Talk, perception quite a bit. It seems to be like one of the pillars in your messaging. Could you explain a little bit when you say perception is purpose?
So when it comes to perspective, I think there's no other value that we mm-hmm. bring to each other than being able to offer, you know, a unique perspective on the world, perspective on one particular event or circumstance. And what I mean by that, especially when talking with entrepreneurs, with people who are trying and desire to make a wider impact in the world, it's really looking at different scenarios that typically come at us from every angle all the time. Like there's never, and it's an endless challenge each and every single day to overcome certain barriers and obstacles and overwhelm or whatever it might be. And you have to be able to shift perception and shift your perspective of what those represent. Are those opportunities for you to be able to grow and for you to be able to learn and kind of get a better understanding of how to apply and overcome certain things in life? Or are those circumstances that are going to be suffocating to your mm-hmm. ability to grow and move forward and understand the world in a different way? It's very, very, you know, I kind of always say this, that you know, success is innately simple because it has to be. You can't, if you overcomplicate it, you're not going to get anywhere. And so it really does come down to being able to simply shift minor elements of your perception on the world, which typically comes through understanding someone else's point of view, whether it's a mentor, whether it's a colleague, whether it is a friend or family member. You have to be able to be willing and empathetic and understanding enough to get where someone else is coming from. And when you can do that, you open yourself up to being able to shift your perception and perspective of what is truly possible. What is the purpose behind what you're here for, what you're doing?
What about if someone is really stuck in a mindset and they can't shift? Like, what would you say to someone who is like, you know, this is a learned pattern of behavior mm-hmm. and their brain only sees it like black or white?
Yep. Well, you said it right there. It's a learned pattern of behavior, which everything is. And again, this is one thing with entrepreneurs that I tend to get a little frustrated with, is like, oh, well, I'm not an entrepreneurial minded person. I don't really have that spunk or whatever the hell you want to call it. And the bottom line is, every single thing in life, we learn. It's a pattern. We learn and we grow with. And so what you're asking is, what if somebody is in that mindset where they can't get out of it, they can't shift?
Mm-hmm.
Then shift the things that you have control of. Number one, you can shift your physiology. So being able to, like, let's say you're just kind of down and your physical being is completely just like into this like horrible low self-esteem feeling, you can shift your physiology. That's one of the easiest and quickest ways to be able to kind of shift your neurological, like your mindset.
Mm-hmm.
The other
by
way,
working out. So you could start that by doing an actual tool of actually working out.
100%. I mean, getting off the couch, getting up, getting out, being active, mm-hmm. You know, on a daily basis and continual basis, and you'll definitely start to see yourself shifting in the way that you feel, the way that you think, all that stuff. Yes, 100%.
Totally agree that the easiest way in is through the body.
100%.
It's the easiest way in.
The other way, which is a little bit more, it takes a little bit more courage and can be more difficult for people, but it is honestly one of the easiest ways that you can absolutely shift really your entire trajectory in life. It really is, get the hell out of the environment that's suffocating you. If you don't like your job, if your job is truly tearing you down, like there's no other option but to get out of that environment, get the hell out of that environment. Like, life is
people, places, things, right? That's what they say.
100%. Like, you know, I see so many people who are kind of getting themselves in the right mindset and they're working out all the time, but they're continuously going back to that same destructive environment every single day, mm-hmm. and you're not going to be able to thrive. And that's the thing, is like, this life and our potential in life is truly to be able to thrive every single day, to be able to thrive at your relationships, your health and vitality, your own personal growth and development, your ability to create financial abundance, all of everything you can thrive at. And if things are not at their true potential, you get to shift and understand, and this is where awareness and perspective and perception comes in, you get to understand which one of those elements is truly not living up to that full potential.
Yeah, because that's like what's holding you back.
100%.
Could you share if you had one specific moment, like a catalyst moment, or was it really a series of those moments where you actually remember the shift taking place?
Yeah. So this is funny. I came up with an acronym for this because this is like what most people talk about as their aha moment, right?
Yes.
Yes. So because I've always, you know, the bottom line is, and I love to be as transparent as possible when it comes to this kind of stuff, there was never one aha moment when you're living in it. When you're living in it, it's a bunch of hell moments that you have to, mm-hmm. like, overcome. But then in hindsight, you kind of look back and you're like, wow, there was that one key moment where I was emotionally attached to that I can really say was like a big moment in time.
Mm-hmm.
But the acronym that I have for that when it comes to aha moments is, you know, that first level is awareness, right? The first A. It's awareness. You're open to a new possibility. So you kind of like, you're kind of, you know, it catches you off guard. You're now aware of something that is possible, right? And mm-hmm. then what happens is we then become, we have an increase or a heightened emotional state. So that's the H, a heightened emotional state. We're mm-hmm. really excited that there's this new thing that we're aware of we can do. Most people have awe moments. They're like,
awe moments. Yes,
ah,
I love that.
That is really interesting. I could apply that in my life. I could actually do that. That makes sense. And they think about it, they get excited about it, and then they do nothing. Most people do this.
What the next A is.
Yes. Yes. They take action. You actually do something. You're actively participating in that awe moment. And that is what allows mm-hmm. you to have that breakthrough, being able to kind of allow yourself to see what is possible in hindsight because you actually actively engaged in the moment, in the emotional being of what you were thinking.
Awesome. Now tell us about your aha moment in the car.
I have aha moments all the time. The aha moment was that I could actually get out of the situations that I had created, meaning I actually could take control of where my life was headed. That was the biggest thing.
So it came to you in just like awareness. Like, the reason I ask is because a lot of people say, okay, well, my aha moment came during great tragedy or whatnot.
Right.
So I wonder, like, did faith play a role in this? Or do you believe that this was just something that you finally were open to?
I mean, I think faith, depending on what context you're using it in, is certainly something that always kind of plays a role. And again, depending on what context you mean that by. But,
well, I call it, I'll tell you what I mean. I call it the God spark, the aha, the you would say, you know, AHA, and you would do your acronym, and I would say, oh, that was my God spark. That was, yeah. So I just labeled it that. And I was like, that's what that was. I had this like divine spark in my spirit. Yeah. And I was like, yes, this is it. Yeah. So me and my friend coined it the God spark.
No, that's totally cool. I think what's great about it is that you don't have to understand it to actually experience it.
Yes.
And I think honestly, where a lot of us tend to get caught up in not taking action on things is because we try to understand every little element of it. So something like that happens, and you can call it the God spark, you can call it an aha moment, you can call it whatever mm-hmm. you want. But if you get caught up in the road of trying to clearly identify and understand everything about it, you might miss the exit where the action happens, and you actually are able to start directing what you want to, what your course is in life. And, you know, with that happening, whenever, you know, kind of I ended up feeling that and understanding what I could actually create, it wasn't a moment where I was like, oh man, I'm feeling something, I now need to explain what that is. It was,
yeah.
I'm feeling something, I know it's real, there's something, there's a reality that I actually have not only a right obligation and responsibility, but an opportunity to actually create what I want in life. I actually have an ability to take full accountability for myself and really become the captain of my fate.
The captain of your ship?
100%.
Okay, now let's talk real. Let's talk about some specific challenges that you faced while this shift was happening, because we all know that it doesn't happen overnight.
Yeah. It doesn't happen overnight, and honestly, to be really real, there's always challenges. Mm-hmm. I still face challenges, and the more successful you are, the more opportunities you create in life, the more energy that you allow into your sphere, into your space,
mm-hmm.
the more challenges you're going to face. And, you know, the opportunities and everything like that, they're going to continuously open up, and the challenges are continuously going to be there. So I'm still facing challenges every single day. They're just different in many ways. And the challenges that I faced back then were more so inner challenges of really getting to know and getting to understand what I could create, what I could do in life, what I meant to be able to create, what I could instill and evoke in other people. So the challenges back then were much more personal growth and development, really understanding and getting a clearer understanding of myself, and relationships for sure, because I had really, you know, in that space back then, I had really alienated a lot of people that I truly cared about, because I was in this pattern of holding back. I was in this pattern of holding back all this negative stuff that I kind of felt was, you know, coming down on me. And in that pattern of holding back, I also got in a pattern of holding back all the good stuff, holding back, you know, me sharing all the good things about me, but also the good things that I cared and really felt about others. So it was more challenges on the inner game, really. And I think that's the first barrier that most people need to face, is like, what is it truly inside of you that's going to open up this opportunity for your full potential to thrive?
I like that you talked about it, that it's the same, it's challenges. They're almost, how I heard it was, it's almost at different levels. Like, for example, as we all continue to grow and work on our personal development, it's like different levels. So, like, for example, it's like, okay, it was such a challenge a year ago for me to get up and speak in a room. Now I'm like, now the room's growing in size. Okay, now the challenge is I could do 20, 30 people. The next challenge is a couple hundred people.
Right.
So it's not like the challenges go away. It just they hold less weight or more weight depending on the circumstance. But they're all still the same. It's like, okay, now I've mastered, you know, these workshops with 50 people. Now, how do I get to the next level and blow thousands of people out of the water, you know?
Right, exactly. And that's, again, this comes down to perception. Those are, you know, suffocating challenges and things that you can be afraid of, and you think, oh my gosh, I'm going to have to now speak in front of 1,000 people. Or that could be just another opportunity and just another level for you to get to and another standard for you to create for yourself, mm-hmm. And being able to expand your influence. And that's
I got a question though on that. Why is it though that the same root problems or fears will come up? For example, whether it's a room of 50 people to 1,000, why does that same fear of like, oh my goodness, I don't know enough, or I feel unworthy, why do those keep coming up, even though you've accomplished so much? Where are you at? Jeremy?
Are you there?
Yep. You're okay. Back in.
So you said, why does that same fear come into play?
Yeah.
So it's essentially because it's not about your outside environment. It's still about you. It's still about you overcoming the fundamental battles and fears and challenges that you face. It's not about the outside environment. So no matter what environment it is, if you have 100 people sitting in front of you, or if you have 1,000 people sitting in front of you, you're going to face the same fear because it's mm-hmm. still you overcoming that challenge. So the fear is typically one that revolves around judgment and one that revolves around being ostracized from the tribe, right? So essentially it comes down to really a biological fear of being ostracized from the rest of the group, and knowing that if that happened, that you would be the sole cause of that. That's a deep fear. That's why public speaking is mm-hmm. like one of the biggest fears, you know, even surpassing death in many ways, right? Because it's the deepest fear that we could possibly have as kind of a tribe species, is knowing that we were the sole cause of our ostracization and judgment by the tribe. So that's kind of, so that's inevitably, no matter how many people are in front of you, it could be one person. Just think of this, it's the same fear and things going on in your mind and your body when you're in front of one person. Let's say you're in front of somebody who you want to have a relationship with. That same fear of rejection and resentment and judgment, it's that same level of fear when you're in front of 1,000 people trying to speak.
Awesome. Well, can you tell us a little bit about, you are the CEO and founder of FitLife Entrepreneur, and I just want you to talk a little bit more about that.
Yeah, so FitLife Entrepreneur is essentially it's a socially conscious company. It's a global platform that really looks to empower the most and bring together the most influential companies, investors, entrepreneurs, and thought leaders who are really transforming the landscape of health and wellness. That's really the goal behind it. It's mm-hmm. to empower those leaders and really give them an opportunity to come together to be able to really take this concept of health and wellness, we're really expanding on a regular basis now, you know, with technology, mm-hmm. with innovative technology, with the innovative ideas coming to play, and really what's going to be happening over the next 5 or 10 years, and the exponential growth of that, there's just so many opportunities to be able to truly transform the way that we even think about health and vitality and living a long, prosperous life, and being fit and being active. We're really learning different, not only things about the human body, but really what it means to be human and what is the potential in the human experience for us to really be able to, you know, live to the fullest. Mm-hmm. So it's FitLife Entrepreneur is really about bringing those active entrepreneurs together around the world, and those leaders and those investors and companies and really the most innovative people in this space, and kind of driving that message, driving in that direction.
So, Jeremy, can you talk a little bit more about the strategic formula for the entrepreneurial peak performance?
Yeah, so when it comes to entrepreneurial peak performance, we've really kind of dived into five really big breakthroughs that really lead to freedom, that lead to entrepreneurial peak performance. The first one is something that we've kind of already talked about, which is awareness, right? So being able to have this level of understanding that something is possible, and that your potential goes beyond and is elevated beyond any other standard that you have kind of set for yourself. So having that level of awareness. The second thing is probably the most critical thing in business, in relationships, in really being able to grow individually, is adaptability. Having some level of adaptability and being able to be able to shift and be able to make those shifts in perception and perspective, and being able to understand that there are different opportunities with any circumstance. And so when you have that adaptability, you're going to be able to grow. The third thing is clarity and really being able to be clear on the path that you're taking with the kind of the purpose and everything that you've created for yourself behind the awareness and understanding what's possible, and then obviously the adaptability, being able to shift the perception of what is in front of you. The fourth thing is authenticity, being able to sink into this space of vulnerability, which most people tend to shy away from in everything, whether it's relationships or anything. They tend to shy away from it, whether it's their health and vitality. They're overweight, so they don't really want to talk about, the health thing. Or maybe, money is a big one. Like a lot of people, they don't want to talk about money. Well, you don't want to talk about money because you have a misguided relationship with it, and you need to understand what that is to be able to then overcome your challenges with money. And being authentic and really understanding where you struggle with that kind of stuff is absolutely critical in that sense, as well as just in being able to connect with people. I mean, authenticity, too many people think that authenticity is about people pleasing and kind of like trying to be nice and all this stuff, but it's not. Authenticity, the root word of that is authoritative. Is being able to stand in the power of who you truly are and just be fully authentic and live in that. Because, and that doesn't mean that everybody's going to like you, that doesn't mean everybody's going to agree with you, but again, that's the value that you can bring to the world, is a unique perspective, right? So as authentic as you can possibly be, that's absolutely key. In today's world of transparency, I mean, try to hide anything today, like, let alone 5 years from now. Like, you're not going to be able to hide anything. Like, whether you're a small business or a big term corporation, like, you have to be authentic. And then the last thing is a commitment, but this goes far beyond just any commitment, because a lot of people are committed to a lot of different things. Somebody overweight is extremely committed to being healthy, extremely committed to getting up every single day and changing their lifestyle. But some people just don't do it. A lot of people are committed to truly creating financial abundance, but yet they struggle to put food on the table. Mm-hmm. You need to have a true commitment and a deep commitment to taking action and to actually being active in your commitments. And I think that's the biggest thing. There's a lot of people talk about commitment to action. I kind of like it as being actively engaged in your commitments. Mm-hmm. Because that not only gets you emotionally attached to what that commitment is, but also it gives you a strategic understanding of what's possible when you do take that first step. So those are really the five key big breakthroughs that I've seen. When people really get those five things, it opens up a whole new world of opportunity for them, and they can really start understanding all the other elements of success, all the other elements of connecting with people and building relationships and, creating the freedom in their life. But those are the five key fundamentals.
Awesome. So let's talk a little bit about impact. What is the FitLife Entrepreneur platform and social impact initiative? What is that vision?
So the vision with that, is obviously FitLife Entrepreneur is all about living an active, healthy, adventurous, and abundant-minded lifestyle, and really empowering others to create that for themselves. And so I really wanted FitLife Entrepreneur to be a part of something, something bigger. And the wider vision is to have FitLife Entrepreneur be a beacon for living a healthy, active, and financially abundant lifestyle. And the way that we do that is by really empowering youth education in fitness and health, but as well as entrepreneurship and being able to kind of be creative and think outside the box and be able to understand the possibilities that you have when you do that. Because the thing is, another sector that is going to be revolutionized, it's already starting, and it's already somewhat transformed over the last few years, is education. That is only going to heighten the level of creativity. It's going to heighten the level of entrepreneurship in the world, and it's going to grow our understanding of what's possible. And so FitLife Entrepreneur, I really want to inspire that. I really want to I want FitLife Entrepreneur to truly be a beacon for that potential.
And you also, I think you have an initiative, so if someone becomes a member, it also, it goes, some of the funding goes towards the education of youth, correct?
Right. So in doing that, in kind of being able to accomplish that mission, portions of profits that we bring in for FitLife Entrepreneur, whether it's through our training programs, our members, our events, that goes towards really being able to, that goes towards the youth education and fitness and health and entrepreneurship and other organizations that that we feel suitable kind of allow us to pursue that mission.
Awesome.
Yeah, and it also allows us to attach our members to this greater cause. That's kind of like the biggest thing too, is like I wanted to have the people in our community feel like they were not only connecting with other people where they could, create ideas that would create a wider impact, but simply by being a part of this community allowed them to immediately attach themselves to a wider goal and a wider mission.
Awesome. And how long have you, because I know you talk about packaging and selling high ticket transformation workshops. Yeah. How long have you been building your workshops in this community?
So yeah, that's one of the things that I've kind of focused on as a coach and as someone who, looks to elevate entrepreneurial peak performance and others. One of those elements is being able to really own your worth and really be able to express that and communicate that in the highest value possible. And so one of the things that we do in the flagship program that I've created, which is the Breakthrough Academy, is really being able to break people through their bullshit that they're not good enough, that they can't create something of value, that they they don't have something of value to bring to others. And so we break those barriers down, and we break through the overwhelm, we break through the limiting beliefs, and then we take that transformation, we take those breakthroughs, and then we turn it into an opportunity for them to be able to create transformative experience or transformational experiences for the people they work with, for their clients. And this is just it's an incredible experience to see people go from, charging or offering a program where they charge a couple hundred dollars and just, it sucks the energy out from them, to being able to see what they truly are worth, understand the value that they really bring to other people, and being able to then capture that, which only is going to elevate the results that they get for people, so it's only going to help the people they work with, and inevitably it only helps them, it builds their confidence, it brings this new life and this new energy to them, to their selves and their business and the people they work around, and it gives them an opportunity to actually create revenue streams that inevitably allow them to reinvest in helping more people. So that's the mission behind that. And I've been fortunate enough to work with and have mentors for my own self and my own transformation and everything mm-hmm. that have opened me up to the strategies, to the opportunities, to the systems and all that stuff to be able to actually create that and create high ticket, high level transformation programs.
I love it.
Yeah.
So what tips can you offer someone who is really struggling to reach their peak performance? Actionable daily practices, anything that someone can take away today and implement right away?
For peak performance in their life, business, what would it be in particular?
I would say, let's just say overall, they're looking to excel. I mean, you can use me as an example. I'm looking to take every area of my life to the next level. And what are actionable steps that I can take every day to get towards those goals?
Number one is, again, you have to be active. You have to be actively involved in your commitments. So understanding what you truly want to create, and this is something that we have for the members in the FitLife Entrepreneur community, they all get a FitLife Entrepreneur Legacy Planner. Mm-hmm. And the reason why this is so absolutely critical is because in that Legacy Planner, you're essentially writing your goals or your accomplishments or your aspirations. You're writing them down twice a day, once in the morning, once in the afternoon, or in the evening. Mm-hmm. And if you're clear in writing those down twice a day, you're going to inevitably achieve most of those goals, if not every single one of them. If you are actively engaged and involved with your commitments, you will absolutely achieve those. If you are consistently writing them down, if you're consistently engaging in them, if you're consistently taking the action each and every day to achieve those, you're going to get there.
So, quick question, what's the difference between that and a to-do list? Because I got me a lot of to-do lists.
Yeah, well, there's a big difference between it. Well, a to-do list is kind of it's kind of forced, right? Like a to-do list is something that you have to do. Oh, it's a to-do list. I have to do that. So it's something that is, you know, people, I've actually seen this in a very profound way have an impact of, people have had a to-do list and they write down all these things that they have to do, and you'll have like a list of 10 to 20 things that you have to do. And people are like, I can never get anything done. And we give them the Legacy Planner, which is strategically placed out to just literally three things that you want to get done the next day by noon. You write those down the night before. And those three things are not just things that you need to do or things that you have to do. Those are literally full commitments that you are dedicated and declaring that you are going to create. There's a big difference between something that you kind of have to do and mm-hmm. something that you are full-blown committed to creating, and there's no other option. And it's again, it's all in the way that you see it. It's all in the perception that you put towards that same exact thing, because they're both the same exact thing, right? You're writing them down on a piece of paper.
Mm-hmm.
Same exact exercise. But in the way that you perceive it and the way that you approach it are going to determine the outcome of what that actually looks like. So, again, actively engaging in your commitments instead of just writing them down.
Cool. I love that.
Yeah.
Do you have a daily self-care practice that you'd like to share with our listeners?
I mean, for me, it's definitely being active. I mean, every single day, I'm out. I'm being active. I'm either hiking. I love weight training. I love being in the gym. So that's something that is very therapeutic for me. Being in the gym, being in that environment of just, again, clear, dedicated focus on what I'm truly committing to creating in my life. I think that there are so many lessons to be learned in the practice of building your body and building your physiology. I think there's so many quality values to be learned in creating that, because there's so many fundamental characteristic traits that you need that are absolute musts in being able to truly create the physiological body that you want. And it's the same thing with your goals and the same thing with your finances, the same thing with relationships. You have to have those fundamental characteristic traits to be able to sustain any level of success. So for me, it's definitely being active. The other thing is, you know, I have a morning ritual, which, you know, full disclosure, by all means, like, there's sometimes that I don't, I unfortunately don't get, like, every little thing right and do it, you know, do it like, okay, at 5:10 a.m. I'm doing this, at 5:11 a.m. I'm doing this. Like, I never get it perfectly right, but there is some level of structure to it so that I have a strategic plan. But the biggest thing is that it always starts the night before. And that's where I see too many people get morning rituals wrong, because it starts in the morning. And it has to start the night before, because if you're not waking up with a purpose, then getting up and trying to create a purpose, you're going to find very difficult.
Yeah. So tell me what you do the night before to set yourself up for success.
It's writing those three critical commitments in the FitLife Entrepreneur Legacy Planner. It's really getting clear on what those are. And it honestly could be as easy as writing down three words that represent what you're looking to create or what you're committed to doing that next morning. But also, I obviously have kind of a structure written out of what I do in the morning to be able to allow myself to get in a space of feeling ready to go and ready to conquer the day. So I do have that outlined, and I typically take a look at that before I go to bed at night and just kind of like focus on it and understand, okay, this is truly what I'm going to go through in the next morning. And then I have those three commitments, and it's like I'm fully dedicated my entire being, and I, like, you know, I'll sometimes just dream about it. That is what I'm going to commit to creating the next day. And then you wake up. When I wake up, it's like it's interesting, because when I wake up and I haven't done that, I'm kind of sluggish. I'm like, I'll hit the snooze button. But when I go through that exercise, and it only takes 5 or 10 minutes before you go to bed, I wake up the next morning and it is like you jump out of bed. You know exactly what you're gonna. You know exactly what your purpose is, and your day is filled with a whole different type of energy.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you, it's much better than dreading a list that's like 50 items long of things that you have to do. Three is manageable and it makes you feel, okay, I feel a little bit better about this, rather than like, oh my God, I have a million things to do, and then you get really overwhelmed.
Again, you cannot overcomplicate success. If you overcomplicate it, you're not going to be successful. Success is innately simple. It has to be. So if you're doing things and whatever it is, if you're writing a to-do list or if you're, you know, creating a financial plan or whatever it might be, if you have that moment of, man, this is really overwhelming, this is really tough, you're doing it wrong. And you're taking a direction of not succeeding, because success is innately simple. Success should be, wow, I get this, awesome. Move forward and take action on it and start creating it and learn as you kind of go and adapt to what's actually going to happen in reality.
Awesome. So to learn more about becoming a member or applying to become a contributor or an affiliate, where should all the listeners go?
Yeah, so they can go to my website, jeremybellotti.com, which I believe is in the...
Yes.
or if you wanted to just email us, you can email Inspire. So Inspire at Team FLE, so Team FitLife Entrepreneur, teamfle.com. So Inspire at teamfle.com. We'll go ahead and, you know, just email us and you know, give us a shout and let us know you want to be a part of the team or a part of the the members area. And we'll get you in. We love hearing from people. We get emails every single day, just people like really wanting to be a part of the movement, really wanting to be a part of the impact that we're having, and really, again, just a lot of gratitude about what we're creating, because there's not a lot of entrepreneurial communities that are dedicated to active entrepreneurs. There's kind of mixture communities, But there's not a lot of those that are truly dedicated to a community that is transforming the landscape of health and wellness.
That I absolutely love. Yeah. Transforming the landscape of health and wellness. That's what my school, IIN, is all about, and they've created a movement. And it's really beautiful to get people to think differently about their health.
Yes.
And to get doctors to think differently. And, you know, IIN is now on Capitol Hill, and they're lobbying to get health coaches and transformational health coaches covered under insurance policies.
Yep.
And that's a wave of the future.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Absolutely. It's one of those things that isn't inevitably going to be revolutionized, the way that we think about it, the way that we consider, you know, what is health and wellness, what is the way, how we think about it, how we learn about it. So that's awesome.
Thank you for tuning in, and make sure you subscribe to this channel to get your weekly fix for all you spiritual gangsters. Any questions or comments, go to my site at taramagalski.com, drop me a note, I'd love to hear from you, and stay tuned for next week. I got the good stuff.